The streak is over. Whiskey Sour Wednesday's back. The Chargers are no longer undefeated when your boy Dan and Dago's in attendance for games. And you know who I blame? I know who's at the root of this. I know who it is. It is Huberto for making me mention the streak in the promos. He jinxed me. He jinxed me and the Chargers. He's like the black cat. He's every superstition you could ever imagine. Whatever. It's a new week on to Pittsburgh. But before we move to week 11, the Compas will recap that ugly Chargers home loss to the Minnesota Vikings and review what went on in the NFL last week. Does anyone want to win the AFC West? What's going on? And why can't it be me? Dan and Dago and Charger fans have something nice. All of a sudden, it's a terrible thing. We got to stop it. The Compas will also look ahead to the Week 11 NFL matchups and discuss a few combat sports. WWE Survivor Series is this weekend, and Terrence Crawford fights Sean Porter on Saturday. It's another exciting episode of Compas on the Beat. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube page at Compas on the Beat. Also, follow us on Instagram at Compas on the Beat and make sure to listen to all the Charger game previews and recaps on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. Now, it's time for the best damn podcast in the universe. Play the music, Nando!
Welcome to Compas on the Beat. I am Fernando Ramirez, Chargers beat reporter for Sports Illustrated, and with me, as always, is my co-host and tag team partner, Gilbert Manzano, OC Register, LA Daily News. What's up, bro?
I gotta let the people know, Fernando, that I suffered through your what's up, bro, 3-4 times right now because we have some technical difficulties behind the scenes of Compas on the Beat. So I did not want to see that 3 times, Fernando. It's one of these mornings where you make me get up. Well, actually, I forced myself to get up because I have a lot of work on this Tuesday and you're busy, but yeah, 3-4 times. What's up, bro, Fernando? I'm ready to get this going.
I know you are. You get excited when we do this. I get excited. I'm like, every Tuesday is like Christmas for me. I'm excited for this. It's always good jumping on, getting to talk a little sports. So obviously, big news off of the weekend, or well, for us, because like we cover the team, but Chargers lose to the Vikings 27-20. We went over some of that stuff and on the post game. Chargers Vikings recap, but Gilbert, now that you've kind of molded over and you heard what Brandon Staley and Kenneth Murray and Corey Lindsey had to say yesterday or on Monday, what, anything change in your opinion, anything different
from Brandon Staley? I don't know, man. They keep telling me that they want to execute better, and I keep trying to figure out what does execute mean. Is it, you know, just, I think Justin Herbert was talking about, you know, it's year one of a new team and they got to figure each other out. Is that the lack of execution? Are people missing their assignments? Are people just not stepping up? Brandon did mention that they're searching for a number 3 wide receiver, a number 2 running back. So at least they're kind of noticing these holes on the roster finally.
Are you trying to plug because Tyron Johnson is a free agent?
I am surprised you did not start with that to start this show, Fernando, because everybody on Chargers Twitter is losing their mind about, you know, go put a waiver claim for T. Billy, Tyron Johnson. And, you know, I don't know if that's going to change anything for this team, but it is a big topic. So I'm surprised you did not go with that.
I mean, could it hurt? I don't think it could hurt.
Well, he's been productive with Justin Herbert, and, you know, it's not working with Jalen Guyton, and Josh Palmer's not ready to contribute right away. So, hey, why not? Like, you have guys in the practice squad, but they're not going to do anything for you either. So, it wouldn't be the end of the world if they don't do it. But, you know, if they do, you know, it's worth a shot.
I mean, it's funny because it's like, obviously, they talk about special teams, and that's mainly one of the reasons why they didn't want him. But it's like, it's one of those things where maybe he doesn't fit their scheme, but maybe he fits what Justin Herbert likes to do. And that's the thing, is that you always, and that's what Brandon came in saying, is that he wanted to put a scheme to fit Justin's skill set. I mean, yeah, maybe Tyron Johnson doesn't do what what Joe Lombardi kind of wants him to do in the offense, but hey, it worked last year for them. So it's going to, he was a surprise cut. I mean, I remember during training camp, at the end of training camp, when the cuts came down, you're like, oh wow, Tyron Johnson. You're like, wow, that's that was pretty interesting. But it's going to be, I mean, I don't know. I'd be interested if they brought him back, and obviously if he does come back and he plays well, everybody's going to be like, well, where the hell was this? Why couldn't this have been the whole season? But I mean, I'm with you. Like, what can you lose from doing it? I mean, who knows? Maybe somebody else picks him up that's in front of you in the waiver wire, but why not? I mean, what do you have to lose really at, I mean, obviously you're at 5-4, you're not in a bad spot. I mean, you're right there. But still, I mean, who knows? Maybe he could be a welcome addition. I don't know what you think.
Yeah. You know, with Justin Herbert, you know, you do kind of need somebody to stretch the field, and that way you kind of create some space for Keenan Allen and Mike Williams. And I know people are really also complaining about the lack of shots down the field, you know, but I think they're taking, you know, a good amount of shots at appropriate times. Also, you can't force everything down the field, but you also need somebody to stretch the field. And if you don't have that, then your shots down the field are going to decline. And then I don't know if Jalen Guyton's doing that because he's not getting the targets. And you would think if he's open, Herbert would throw him some balls his way. That is not happening. So I don't think he's doing enough there. And it's just tough with Josh Palmer because he doesn't do that type of role. But he seems to be a good playmaker. But you already have Mike Williams and Keenan Allen, and it's kind of a tough fit right there. So, you know, why not take a shot with Tyron Johnson? And I know we're spending a lot of time on T. Billy, but you know, it's weird because he had a hot start to training camp. He was productive last year in spots, but I think, you know, what we were told was like they were trying to focus more on a receiver who could play special teams. He wasn't doing that. A receiver who could block in the running game, he wasn't doing that. So he was very, you know, kind of a one-trick pony kind of thing, and that's not what the Chargers wanted. But now that one trick is something they need, so why not go take a shot? I don't think they're going to claim him. The best shot is to wait until he's, you know, not claimed. And maybe he won't this time because he went to a really bad Jaguars team and didn't produce there. So people are going to be like, okay, maybe this guy is not who we thought he was. And maybe the Chargers are like, you know what, we could actually fix this guy if he goes unclaimed, take a shot. So we'll see.
You know, and you're completely right. I mean, you just haven't seen that production from Jalen Guyton. 11 catches. He'll make one catch in one game, disappear for two games. And I mean, I've told you before, he runs a lot. I mean, he's in great shape. So it's just one of those things. No, and I'm being honest. I mean, it's one of those things where it's like you just don't see the production that there was last year. Is it maybe the new scheme? Who knows? But that's what the Chargers said, that Jalen fit exactly what they wanted to do. You haven't seen the production from it. There's times where, like we've said, Keenan and Mike are taken away, and Jalen isn't one of those guys that steps up and says, okay, with those guys out, like with those guys taken away, I need to step up now. He doesn't do it. And I mean, and it's not because of him, it's maybe because he doesn't fit the scheme. Maybe he just doesn't have it. Who knows? It just one of those things where why not just bring in Tyron Johnson and see what he has? I mean, if he goes unclaimed and everything. Maybe try it out with him. Maybe you sit Jalen Guyton one game and he doesn't dress. You just Tyron and see what he can do. I mean, what do you – it's not like Jalen plays special teams. It's not like he plays kickoff return or he's on a punt block team or whatever. Like, he doesn't do any of that stuff. So, I mean, maybe Tyron Johnson can give you a spark. But it's going to be interesting to see kind of what direction the Chargers try and go. I mean, they did get Dustin Hopkins. They did get Andre Roberts. Both guys have been very good for them. Maybe Tom Telesco goes 3-for-3 with waiver claims midway through the season, and Tyron comes back and he plays well. But I don't know. It's just interesting to see kind of what happens with him, especially because, I mean, like I said, it's one of those unknowns. And you said it, Gilbert. He does something that you need right now. And who knows? Maybe he comes back, you put on that 83 jersey, and he starts flying again.
You know, I guess if you want to put a percentage on it, I think maybe it's a 40% chance that they do go out, because, you know, Brandon Staley said they need a number three wide receiver. And
Fernando's number two.
Sorry, who?
Fernando.
Oh, you've been saying that all year. You've been saying that since the draft, Fernando. So I'll give you credit on that, and it's kind of hurting them right now. So, but for Brandon to say, okay, we need a number three wide receiver to step up, and that's kind of maybe the most he's kind of been, you know, straightforward with that response. And you're the guy who's always asking him about number three receiver. So he's kind of like, you know what, Fernando, you're right, finally.
He's probably like, you're just beating the spit out of that drum. I've been beating it from both sides. A second running back and a third receiver just banging the drum and banging the drums.
So I don't know what you think for percentages, but, you know, when Brandon Staley says that, and then I think the split for the snap count was 18 snaps for Guyton, 18 snaps for Palmer, then you know he's searching for something.
Yeah, no, definitely. And that's why I keep on asking, like, what do you think about what's going on and everything? So, breaking news right now. Mike Tomlin said that they are building the game plan up as if Mason Rudolph is the quarterback for the against the Chargers this weekend.
And I was going to say, because you know what's pissing me off, but I probably should save my Steelers comments.
Yeah, save it for the pod preview on Thursday.
But I'm just so annoyed with this Chargers team that I don't care who plays anymore against them. So I'll just leave it at that.
just real quick, just to end this topic. I don't know what percentage I see it at, but you got to do something. I mean, why not? I mean, just let it. You're looking for something. Why not go out there and get it? That second the running back spot, I really don't think it's going to get taken over this year. That's why I asked Brandon Staley, have you guys even thought about going after Darius Bradwell, maybe bringing him up, letting him see what he has? Because he's a thumper. He's a Melvin Gordon kind of and I'm not comparing him to Melvin Gordon, but he's a thumper. He's a guy who hits. Anthony Lynn called him a Ford F-150, so it definitely a souped up a Ford F-150. So, and the Chargers kept him for a reason. I don't know, go out there, throw him out there and see if he's got a little bit of juice. But going back to the Tyron Johnson, I'll put it at 51% that they go. I really do think that they might go after him. I think that they're kind of like, oh, let's try something. Let's see, like, you have the wall right now, throw crap at it and let's see if it sticks. So I really do think that they might try and go hard at him just to see if maybe that's a spark that gets this offense going. You never know. And like I've been telling you, Gilbert, like I've told everybody since they drafted Justin Herbert, you can never get a young quarterback like that enough weapons. Why not?
Yeah, you know, the more the better. And some of these really, you know, explosive offenses do have three receivers who are stepping up and capable. And then, you know, for people who enter fantasy football, you kind of hate it because you don't know where the ball is going. But for opposing defenses, they hate it just as much because, again, you got to defend multiple guys. So, you know, I say go for it, especially at this time of need where what's been now, what, three out of the last four games where you've had very disappointing offensive performances. So when it's three out of four, there's a problem. It's not just a fluky hiccup here. So, you know, it's not the end of the world, like I said, if they don't go for him, but they got to try something because at least that number three spot is not working. If you don't go for another wide receiver, then you better get more tight ends involved. You better get Austin Ekeler more involved in the passing game. But the thing about Austin Ekeler, when you don't have a number two running back helping in the running game, then that kind of limits Austin Ekeler in the passing game. So there's all these kind of hiccups that they have going on to have all their weapons involved.
Yeah, no, 100%. Now, Gilbert, as we move on, there's been a theme today. Fernando's right. I kind of like that. I think we should continue that theme. Oh, wow. Look at what just popped up. Rams versus 49ers. The Rams have been in the news lately. They traded for Von Miller. They got OBJ. Odell Beckham Jr. decided to sign with them. There's been a lot surrounding the Rams and what they've been doing. I hate to say I told you so, and I guess we're only in week 10. But they did not look good last night or on Monday night. They lost to the 49ers 31-10. It was not a pretty sight. Gilbert, I'm gonna let, before I go on my Paul Heyman-esque rant, I'm gonna let you see what you thought.
You know, I'm not annoyed about you taking your victory lap because one, I have my I told you so moment later on in the show, so we'll be even there. But I don't think it's early for you to take that victory lap because what has transpired the last two games is kind of showing you what Matthew Stafford was in Detroit. And these were two big primetime games against two teams you should have beaten. And you load it up with Von Miller, you load up with OBJ, and you have back-to-back clunkers like that. And it's not because, you know, the defense looked pretty bad, especially in the run game against Kyle Shanahan. It's like, aren't you going to change your scheme a little bit? Like the 49ers love to run the ball. they're not going to have you, you know, face Jimmy Garoppolo 50 times because they don't really trust Jimmy like that. And you don't make adjustments. But sticking to the quarterback, Matthew Stafford, I think that's where you want to go, Fernando. You can't start the game with back-to-back interceptions, one being a pick six, and not just back-to-back in the game, back-to-back in 2 weeks in a row. Like, that's where you put your defense also in a deficit, 14-0 off the bat. And that's why, Matthew Stafford didn't have the best team in Detroit. It sucks for him to be there, whatever, 10-plus years and have kind of a bad defense all the time, a bad running game all the time. He did have Megatron, but it was always up and down because he was inconsistent. You know, he was making mistakes. But when he was on, man, nobody could make the throws that he could make, and it was pretty. But when you're the Rams, I'm sure they considered this after watching 12 years of film on him, and you're going to trade 2 first-round picks, that there's going to be some highs and some lows. But are the lows worth it? And they're really starting to catch up. And I think Fernando, after we've seen Stafford since, I forget when he was drafted, 2009, the first overall pick, we know who you are. And you thought that, you know, with a better supporting cast, he'll play better. And he was. He was playing kind of in an MVP form. I know you'll laugh at that. But he was doing pretty good at first. But I guess, Fernando, when you're telling me that you've seen this movie before, I should have believed you. They're going to be fine. They're going to make the playoffs. Yeah. But I don't have trust in Matthew Stafford to lead you all the way now after what I've seen the last 2 weeks.
So I want to play something that was sent to me this morning by our good friend Emmanuel Morgan, friend of the show. We need to have Emmanuel on one day.
Yeah.
Because he's doing a lot of really great stuff. I love seeing his stuff. But he sent me a clip featuring one of our other good friends of the show, Gilbert, Eric Williams. Let me show you what I got for you.
All right.
How do you prepare for a guy like Deebo Samuel, a unique player? How do you game plan for a guy like that?
Who?
Deebo Samuel.
Who's that?
How do you
I've never seen that. That was last year, I'm assuming?
Yeah, it was last year. So Eric was asking, like, how do you prepare for somebody like Deebo Samuel? And Aaron Donald's like, who? Like, trying to play it off like Debo's not a superstar. Man, the dude lit him up last night. 5 receptions, 97 yards and a touchdown. But that 40-yard touchdown was pretty nuts because it was on 3rd down. The way he made that in between.
I think it was 4th down, bro.
4th down. Yeah. Yes, you're right. In between a receiver or in between a corner and a linebacker, ends up sprinting. The dude's a beast. I mean,
it was like the same play from the prior, maybe 2 plays earlier.
Yeah, exactly. It was the exact same play. I know you think I'm going to go against Matthew Stafford.
Okay. What's your bone to pick? I'm curious.
It's the design of the way that the media and everybody approaches the Rams. Like, the Rams put in a couple of weeks ago that all in their social media. And the media starts going crazy. And they're like, oh, my God, the Rams. Look at what the Rams are doing. I've been called a hater for years because of this. Nick Hamilton, great friend of the show as well.
Oh, you're going to name names?
Yeah, he calls me a hater. But no, a lot of people call me a hater, and I'm not a hater. I've just seen this stuff. Like, okay, so the reason why I'm going with this is because.
Can you also pet peeve of mine, you can't just blame the media. You know, when people say you're a hater as an easy excuse to kind of, you know, end an argument, when people say the media, that's another easy one. Don't say the media. Say Nick.
No, Hamilton. I mean, okay, our colleagues were crowning the or Rams.
Some. We say some.
Some of the media. Yeah, no. Some of the, okay, yeah.
Maybe one of these fake of the news media. People.
No, yeah. Some of the media were crowning the Rams as, oh my God, look what they're doing. Flashy plays don't win. Flashy moves don't win you Super Bowls. It does win you NBA championships. It does win you other awards. When it comes to the NFL, that does not win you Super Bowls. The Eagles tried it a couple of years ago when they had all this talent. Remember, I think it was Vince Young that said, we're an all-star team. They didn't win. Teams like this do not win. Why? Gilbert, when is the next time that the Rams have a draft pick?
No
2024.
Idea.
So why, or like, I think it's either a first or a draft pick. I can't remember which one it is, but when the Rams' best chance to win a Super Bowl was last year, Fernando, why was it last year? That defense had depth on it. That defense had depth. They had players behind players. They had players that could do a lot of things. They don't have that depth anymore. John Johnson is now gone. What was their slot corner? Troy Hill is now gone. They do have some good players, but where do you get your depth? In the draft. They don't have the draft picks of the future to kind of get that depth. They have been ignoring something that the Chargers ignored for a little while. The offensive line, that offensive line is not good. That offensive line cannot open holes. That often, and I'm talking about against really good teams, they cannot. They beat the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Okay, I'll give you that one. Tampa Bay, though, the same Tampa Bay that they might meet in the playoffs is not the same Tampa Bay that they played, where Sean McVay was running around, high-fiving players, chest-bumping DeSean Jackson. That ain't going to be the same team you're going to face. That team gets serious, and I'm sure Tampa Bay, I know they lost to Washington over the weekend, but I'm sure they'll snap back. This team does not have the depth that it once did. They have one really good cornerback in Jalen Ramsey, and then they have players, other players around him. They have Von Miller, they have Aaron Donald, and they have Leonard Floyd. Last night, they weren't getting it done. The offensive line for the 49ers took it to them. It's going to be interesting to see, but I was sort of kind of faking last week when I thought, you know what, maybe this might be able to work with Odell, with Robert Woods, with Cooper Kupp, because you kind of take that, you kind of take away from Cooper Kupp that necessity to be the number one receiver, be catching, and you kind of take away the Calvin Johnson effect from him, which is good because that means you might be able to free him up a little bit more and Matthew Stafford can spread the ball around. Friday, you get the news that, or for Saturday morning, you get the news that Robert Woods has a torn ACL. Then that's when I became a little worried, not worried, but I'm like, I don't think this is going to work. Now they're going to be Odell-centric. Matthew Stafford hones in on receivers. He's going to be honing in on Odell or Cooper Kupp, and that's it. Van Jefferson yesterday, I thought, had a big three catches, 54. But Cooper Kupp had 11 catches, 122 yards. We've seen some teams take him away. What's going to happen when he's taken away? Matthew Stafford isn't known as a guy that's going to be able to spread the football around and make plays. So I don't think this model works. I don't think it's going to work for the Rams. The Green Bay Packers are better than the Rams. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers are better than the Rams. I don't know about the Dallas Cowboys. That one I'm a little bit more hesitant on. Who's the other team? Oh, Arizona. Arizona is a better team than the Rams. So I don't think this model is going to work. I don't think the Rams are going to be at SoFi Stadium. I'm saying that today, Tuesday, November 16th at 9:35 a.m., the Rams will not win the Super Bowl this year. They're going to be a playoff team, but they're not winning the Super Bowl. They might make it. Who knows? Maybe injuries happen to other teams, but I just don't see them making it. Not without Robert Woods, not without a better offensive line, not with some better linebacker, without some better linebackers, not without a little bit of more help for Jalen Ramsey in that secondary. But I don't trust the Rams. I wouldn't put anything down on the Rams just because I don't think they're the team that everybody thinks that they are. Flashiness, cool. Yeah, you're LA. You got the flashy, you're Hollywood, but flashy doesn't win Super Bowls, and that's why I'm saying I don't think they're going to win that. I don't think they win the Super Bowl this year.
Yeah, they're going to have some chemistry issues with getting Odell incorporated, especially not at a faster rate after losing Robert Woods. And you saw it really hurt them in that the 49ers game because, one, if you know, everything that you were expecting not to go wrong happened because you couldn't play from behind, because when you play from behind, you need up-tempo. And guess who doesn't know the playbook yet? Odell Beckham doesn't know the playbook. So he couldn't even be on the field because you were playing at a faster pace. And you could tell McVay, was like, you know what? We can't do it yet because you don't know the playbook or the routes, you know? And that was hurting them. And you were down Odell Beckham pretty much. And Robert Woods is not around to kind of do what he does. So like you mentioned, it was just Cooper Kupp. Van Jefferson had a good amount of drops, but he contributed also a little bit, but it wasn't enough. Then you mentioned the whole thing about honing in on receivers. The first interception on Stafford, he forced that ball to Odell Beckham. I know people were saying Odell should have kept running, but there was two guys there. And it was so obvious that once he wanted the play to keep going, he was going to go to Odell the whole way. So they're kind of trying to force feed him early, and it didn't work out.
Not even Mr. Fantastic could have made that damn catch.
It wasn't tough for Gardner. I know he could have kept running to maybe prevent the pick, but that was just a dangerous pass overall. And then you start force feeding things. And Fernando, I hate being this guy, the guy who's pissed off about fantasy football, but I lost my matchup yesterday because they didn't kick that damn field goal when they went for the.
Oh, you're one of those that lost because of that.
I lost by 2 points. So if they would have got the field goal, I would have won.
I won one of my leagues by 0.5 when he sent out Matt Gay. I honestly thought they were going to throw it to Cooper Kupp. Cooper Kupp was about to kill me, And no, the 49ers, he had the 49ers defense and Cooper Kupp. 49ers defense dropped an interception. I was like, oh, thank God. Then they didn't go. They decided to kick. And I was like, oh, my God. I was like, there you go. Done. I won by 0.5.
I was actually set up to win that way. But the guy I was facing had Elijah Mitchell. And obviously the next drive, he got a couple carries and I lose by 2 points. So I keep thinking about the fake field goal, which was weird at the time. Like, if you're going to go.
And you weren't even that down all that much.
And even that, if you're going to go for a fake try, why don't you just have Stafford throw the ball instead of your punter? So it was a weird attempt there. But overall, it was just a bad day for the Rams. But, you know, I think they're going to figure it out to make a decent run at it, because I don't think the Cowboys or the Cardinals are ready yet. They haven't been through kind of playoff experience. I know Dak has in years, but they've never really done anything in the playoffs.
Matthew Stafford.
I know, but I'm not saying they're gonna win. When you start eliminating the teams, if they figure it out just on talent, but they have holes, like you mentioned, the offensive line, they have holes on defense. So I don't know if they could figure that out.
And Green Bay's defense right now is playing lights. They held Mahomes to 13 points.
Yeah, so those are the two teams right now. The Packers and the Buccaneers are ahead of the Rams just because they have the chemistry and maybe they have a little more depth. I don't know if I could trust the whole Rodgers drama in Green Bay. So I go back to the Buccaneers. So maybe they'll figure. I know they lost to Washington, but maybe they'll figure it out. But I think they'll be in the division around at least the Rams. But after that, I don't know if I could trust them after that.
100%. Gilbert, real quick, Week 10 recap. I'm gonna throw out some scores at you and be which game surprised you more. So which one surprised you more, the Lions and the Steelers tying, or the Patriots blowing out the Browns 45-7? Mac Jones is good.
Yeah, I guess I go with the Patriots one because Mason Rudolph played in that Lions game and so. It was kind of bound to happen. You have a wounded animal and the Lions are going to fight to the end. So I could see that. But I thought it was going to be a little closer, the Patriots and the Browns. And they really blew out the Browns. And Mac Jones has been playing well. And you know what's funny with the Patriots? You know, I think it's most of us thought that the Chargers could beat the Cowboys in Week 2 and the Chargers could beat the Patriots at home. And they didn't. But it kind of turns out these two teams are actually pretty good. So not trying to give any excuses to the Chargers, but so far the teams they've been playing have been pretty good. So, you know, since they played the Chargers, the Patriots are really good. I think before that game, they lost to the Cowboys. Then they played the Chargers, and the Patriots haven't lost since then. So they found their stride since being at SoFi Stadium. I think Mac Jones has been kind of up and down, but this last game, he was pretty good, and people have been really praising him. He's not he doesn't make it look pretty out there. He's not the most talented out there. But he's getting it done, and he's moving the chains, and making it work with what he has. So, you know, I was very surprised with that one.
Sorry. By the way, Tyrann Mathieu threw out a lot of love at Mac Jones today, and he hasn't even faced Mac Jones. But he's like, oh, all you guys were hating on him before the draft, and now all of a sudden y'all are praising him. He's like, get out of here. And I feel the same way. I'm with Tyrann on that one. Gilbert, last one. Which one surprised you more? Miami Dolphins 22, Baltimore Ravens 10. Or the Broncos 30 or the Eagles 30, Broncos 13.
I go with the Ravens one. The Dolphins really pretty much dominated that game, which is weird. I think the Ravens are a good playoff team, and the Dolphins are not. So to kind of get crushed that bad on Thursday Night Football, and I was trying to, you know, give Lamar some praises, and he goes and throws out a stinker there. So I was very surprised.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on that one. I was surprised that they didn't play all that well, just because, I mean, it was kind of, you go into your bye week, or your a long week, I guess, and you get to relax, and they probably couldn't relax. They probably had that bad taste in their mouth. But now let's jump to week 11, Gilbert. Here are the slate of games that are going to take place. So I don't know what the game I'm looking at already is Indy versus Buffalo, just right off the bat. Indy versus Buffalo. I don't know. What do you think about that one? Who you got?
Indy's kind of been, I don't know, kind of like the Chargers. You can't really figure them out. They have some good moments and some bad moments. You know, they're a tough team to kind of beat, though. So, you know, for a team like the Bills that, you know, is known for beating the good teams but then kind of losing to the bad teams, this might be a good test for the Bills. Okay, you know, an average team, and, you know, snap out of it and beat them and show us that you're really a true AFC contender. But it's a sneaky good one. I'm sure there's better matchups out there.
I'll take who you got? Buffalo?
Yeah, I'll take Buffalo to finally wake up.
I'll go with you. I think Buffalo just blew the doors off of the Jets. And I know that's nothing, but I mean, the Patriots
blew the Jaguars.
Yeah, but the Patriots or the Buffalo Bills or the Patriots blew the doors off of the Jets, and then they came into SoFi and they were able to beat the Chargers. So I think Buffalo also will snap out of it after blowing the doors off of the Jets, and I think they'll beat Indy. Baltimore, Chicago, that's a sneaky good game, especially with the way Chicago plays defense. And is Baltimore going to be able to bounce back? What do you think about that one?
Not bad, but I did enjoy watching Justin Fields on Monday Night Football against the Steelers. So, hey, I'm curious to see what he does after that. Were they on a bye week? I feel like I haven't heard anything on Justin Fields. I think they must have been on a bye week. But
they were on a bye week.
Okay, so to come back after that kind of impressive performance, I'm curious to see what Fields does.
I'm going to go Chicago.
Really?
Yeah.
I go. Where's the game at?
In Chicago.
Ooh, I'll say Ravens bounce back. They're a well-coached team.
Okay, I'm scrolling back down to, let's go, Cincy at Las Vegas. Cincy had a bye week. The Raiders just got blown out by the Kansas City Chiefs. I'm going to go Cincinnati.
I think the Bengals are going to a two-game losing streak, huh?
Yeah.
I think the Raiders are gonna wake up, and they're at home after getting blown out like that. I think they'll come back and bounce back.
Dallas at Kansas City.
Is this where I could have my victory lap on? Well, not victory lap, but kind of I told you so on the Chiefs.
Are you kidding? After 1 week, you're gonna run around and you're gonna celebrate?
Hey, they're in first place, right?
Give me the Dallas Cowboys.
You told me the Chiefs are done, dead in the water. They're not going to do anything with this defense, and they're in first place, Fernando.
Dan and Dago, is the season over?
You're the one taking a victory lap for the Rams, but...
Hey, that is a lot of instances where I can prove that they have not been good. They haven't been able to... Matthew Stafford is the same core. See, that's the thing. I ain't gonna get into it.
Then let me put it this way, Fernando. Who do you think is better than the Chiefs in the AFC West? Because I don't think it's the Chargers. I don't think it's the Broncos, and I don't think it's the Raiders right now. These teams.
I know that, but like, how do I know the Chiefs are completely back? That's the thing. Is that I don't think the Chiefs are back, and I'm not
look
saying
the,
that.
The, look
I'm
at the division, Fernando. There's nobody who's gonna scare them right now because everybody's in this mediocre division right now. Like nobody wants
okay to but what it. Happens if Kansas City comes in? What if Kansas City loses to Dallas? What are you gonna say then?
Well, they'll still be in the division race because nobody wants it, and that's all I'm saying. They're gonna probably win the division because nobody wants it, you know.
Yeah, but to me, when you said they're gonna wake up at one point, like to me that means that you think that they're an AFC championship contender.
I meant they're going to be in the playoffs and they're going to be fine, but I didn't say they're going to win the division. I mean, no, the conference.
Fine to me means they're going to be back to normal, back to...
You were pretty much saying right in the old bit, saying this team is not doing anything this year. So I'm just saying they're going to do something. And it's looking like they're going to win a division right now because nobody wants it.
But that's how this is. These first few months have gone. I think it was the month of September. It looked like the Raiders were going to win the division. The month of October, it looked like the Chargers were going to win the division. Now it looks like the Chiefs are going to win it in November. So does that mean that the Broncos are going to look like they're going to win it in December?
No. I'm telling you, friend, the teams that play better in November are the ones that tend to win this thing. And right now,
to me, it's the teams that play in December.
And the Raiders, I don't know, friend. I'm probably going to piss off a lot of Chargers listeners, but they have a lot of issues. And I'd rather trust a team that's done it before in the Chiefs. And they're playing the Cowboys? I'll say the Chiefs continue it, man, and prove me right. I'll go with the Chiefs.
All right, I'm going to go with Dallas. Dallas has a lot of firepower on that offense. Michael Gallup is back. CeeDee Lamb is playing at a high level. Amari Cooper, Ezekiel Elliott. That Chiefs defense is going to be their Achilles heel, and it's not that same Chiefs defense that it was when they won the Super Bowl and all that. I don't think that they're going to be able to – I think Dallas will go in there and beat them at home. So that'll put them at 5-5, and then things get really interesting. I think they go on their bye week after this week.
No, I think they'll be 6-5.
What are they right now?
I think they're 6-4.
Oh, yeah. They're a week ahead of the Chargers. Okay, so they'd be 6-5. No, you're right.
Yep, 6-4. So, yeah, the Chargers already beat them once, so they have that going for them. But what happened to this division, man? Fernando, it just kind of like a month ago, we're like, this is a pretty good race. And now it's like.
But I thought I never thought it was a four-headed race. I always thought it was more of a two-headed race. Because I told you from the beginning, I didn't believe in the Raiders. I didn't believe in the Broncos. I still don't believe in the Chargers all that much. But I feel like if they can kind of, well, I mean, the thing is, you at this point in the season, you can't hide your deficiencies anymore. And the Raiders just couldn't get anything going last week. But I think the Chiefs are kind of masking it with the Raiders got older in their secondary. And the Chiefs just took advantage of it. They had nobody that could keep up with them, nobody that could do anything. And the Chiefs don't have anybody that can cover Travis Kelce. So that's kind of where things got a little bit reckless. But
the thing with the Chiefs, though, like I get that the defense is bad, and you keep saying that they're going to suffer with that. But this conference, even the entire conference, nobody wants it. And for some reason, I keep not trusting the Titans, but they keep winning. So maybe I'm wrong with the Titans, but for a team to beat the Chiefs, you better score points. And do you see the Titans lining up the scoreboard if they play in the playoffs? The only team I can see lining up the scoreboard if they wake up finally is the Bills. So that's the only team I see right now potentially better than the Chiefs down the line.
No, I see I think the Titans could light the Chiefs up again. It would just have to be you need to have Julio Jones back from IR. You need to have all these guys back. You
have Henry too if he comes back.
Derrick Henry if he comes back. No, yeah, and that's the thing. Without Derrick Henry, excuse me. Without Derrick Henry, this gets this is a lot more complicated. So you're right on that. I think that the Bills are ultimately going to end up beating the Chiefs at one point. And that's the thing.
But if it was in the AFC title game, isn't that enough to say the Chiefs are still who we thought they're going to be? You don't think an AFC title appearance is good?
No, because it's only going to get worse from here on out. No, I'm serious. Mahomes' contract now starts to weigh on you. Some of these other contracts are going to win. And then Tyreek Hill's a free agent after, not this year, but next year.
I'm not talking about the long game. I'm talking about this year. And I think for them, if they make it to the Final Four, it's another typical year. And you're trying to say this year they won't be the same Chiefs, but maybe I'm getting ahead saying they're going to go that far, but I think they're going to be in a good spot at the end of the year.
We'll see. Now we're going to go to your wheelhouse because this is all you. I'm going to let you take the floor. Give me why should I watch this fight this weekend, Gilbert?
That's a good way to set it up. But, you know, I won't push you too much, but because I am a disappointed boxing fan and I am intrigued by this matchup, Terrence Crawford against Sean Porter. And it's not, and it's a pay-per-view fight, which I hate. It shouldn't be a pay-per-view fight. I should double check. I think it is, though. It's not a big name household kind of thing. We're gonna go and buy the fight where Canelo's fighting it. That's not what it is, but they put it on pay-per-view, so I'm mad about that. But what I'm mostly mad about is Terrence Crawford is not fighting Errol Spence Jr. And it seems like that's not gonna happen.
$70.
Yeah, I don't blame you. You don't want to pay $70, but it's I'm not gonna sell you like a promoter, but it's a decent matchup. If you can find other ways around to watch it, I say do it. But you know, they waited too long on Errol Spence Jr. And then you know Errol Spence got into the car accident. He came back and it seems like he's still the same guy. So they had an opportunity to make the fight. They still didn't make the fight. And we're barely at the stage where Terrence Crawford is finally somebody who's a true contender. And Terrence Crawford has been this guy who has a lot of skill. We put him in the top pound for pound rankings because of the eyeball test, but he's never been tested. He's never been challenged until now, Sean Porter, finally. But Terrence Crawford is like 33, 34 years old. Why are we waiting so long? So everything about this fight kind of annoys me, but I'm also like, okay, at least they're doing it and I'm going to watch. But if you're not familiar with Terrence Crawford, he is one of the best pound-for-pound fighters in terms of skill. and you want to see him get tested. The guy who does that for you is Sean Porter. And I guess apparently Fernando with these combinations. But Sean Porter is a guy who's going to take you to deep waters, really test you to see if you come out on top, then you're, you know, legit contender. But Sean Porter is also a guy who, when it comes to big fights, he's fought a lot of good fighters. He doesn't win most of these fights. Like, he beat Danny Garcia, but he lost to everybody else who's a big fighter. Keith Thurman, Kell Brook. I could go on and on with Sean Porter. Oh, he lost to Errol Spence. But credit to Sean Porter, he fights people. And he I don't think he's ever been knocked out. He's been dropped. But he is relentless. He's an awkward fighter. If you're doing moves for Allen, he's one of these guys that goes like this and just comes at you. But he's like a bulldog out there. He's a fighter. But he doesn't have the skill that Terrence Crawford has. So, you know, I'm intrigued because I am a sucker for interesting boxing fights. But I just hope after this fight, Crawford and Spence get in the ring and finally give us what we want. It might be a little late by then, but enough is enough. Let's stop waiting and stop charging people $70 because this is not a pay-per-view worthy fight. It would have been a good ESPN primetime fight, but we did not get that.
By the way, he has lost three fights, and all three of them were by decision. No knock. He hasn't been knocked out.
Yeah, he's tough, and I think I named all three losses: Kell Brook, Keith Thurman, and Errol Spence. And these are some of the best, you know, in the welterweight division. And I got to interview Sean Porter many times when I was working in Las Vegas. He's a great dude. He's very talented, also the commenter. He works hard, but he's just missing that kind of that skill part. You know, he just kind of throws a lot of crazy hooks at you, and then he kind of goes at your body, and that works for him. He's kind of like a Mexican fighter. But Terrence Crawford he's too slick. Man, he's a guy who could fight from southpaw stance, who's a righty, has enough power, a great jab, a technician, but he's never been tested. So that's why I'm intrigued, because Porter will test you, and it just sucks that Porter's not really the top of the top, but he's definitely worthy of being with the contenders.
I'll watch it for free, but because I'm interested. I mean, I've heard of Terrence Crawford. I've heard of Sean Porter. They're both very skilled fighters, both guys that I think could take it. It could be a good match. So I'll watch it for free, but I ain't paying 70 or $70 for this. But who do you got?
I'll go Terrence Crawford. I think Porter would put up a good fight, but I'm going to, I never seen him be tested, but I'm going to go off the eyeball test. And Fernando, you're more based on experiences, but I think Crawford's shown enough in the skill part that he could beat somebody who's well experienced. But I don't know, some good fights, Fernando, coming up in boxing. There's gonna be not really a good matchup, but Gervonta Davis, one of the stars of boxing, mm-hmm. fights at Staples Center in December next month. But I saw that we're gonna be in Cincinnati for that weekend. So that kind of stinks there. That would have been fun to cover that one.
Red eye, bro.
Yeah, right. And I think the fight's on a Sunday. So, which is like, for some reason, really? Mayweather promotion likes doing fights on Sundays.
They
want to
compete with the NFL.
Yeah, but they view Gervonta Davis as the next Mayweather. So that's probably their way of saying, hey, we could compete with anybody. We don't care who is on TV. So I'm not surprised by that. And Gervonta is pretty much beloved. He's not the best kind of promoter or talker, but he has his reputation where people really want to see him fight. When he fights, a lot of NFL players want to watch him fight. I've noticed that. But they've got that one, Gervonta. We just had Canelo fight. So a decent way to end the year with boxing.
You're forgetting a big fight.
Well, don't tell me the Jake Paul.
All right, let's move on.
I'm not paying for that either.
Yeah, no, I neither shan't I.
All right, Fernando, what do you got for me? Give me your expert area.
I'm disappointed, Gilbert. I feel like at times there's no effort put into stuff. And as a guy who showed almost no effort in high school for academia, there's laziness going on, and I hate it. This is Survivor Series, Gilbert. This has to be Raw invades SmackDown. SmackDown invades Raw. Like, you have to be having madness. Like, I remember a couple of years ago, the Big Show and Kane, when they were a tag team, they invaded SmackDown, and they freaking powerbombed Batista, who was already hurt. You got Becky Lynch, who got her nose broken by Nia Jax a couple of years ago after she had almost torn Ronda Rousey's arm off of her socket. You got stuff like that. And this year, it's boring. Survivor Series is about to be about both brands fighting each other, and they just don't – they don't have anything. I mean, this is the matchup so far, and I'm going to give you my what's it called? My three God, where did I just I'm a little disappointed just because I was kind of hoping for more. But the first one, obviously, the one match that I'm gonna be I'm definitely gonna keep an eye on is your tribal chief Gilbert goes up against Big E. That's gonna be a good match. It's both the WWE champion versus the Universal champion. It's gonna be a good matchup.
Whoever wins that fight, do they become the undisputed?
No. This is just Raw versus SmackDown. That's why I'm telling you, like, there's a lot of laziness going on. Like, these guys aren't like this should have been hyped up a lot more because it is the tribal chief against Big E. Big E had a big win over Bobby Lashley when he cashed in his Money in the Bank and won his first ever WWE championship. The WWE has done a good job of building up both Reigns and Big E. The Usos came over to Monday Night Raw and kind of beat up Big E, and they're like, hey, this is a message from the tribal chief. Then he gets up and starts beating them up, and he says, you tell Roman Reigns I got something for his ass on Friday. So maybe Big E shows up on Friday on SmackDown. I got the tribal chief winning that one. I just think that they're doing something with this Roman Reigns character. They're building him up. They're something is going to happen at WrestleMania. I don't think he's going to fight just any Joe Schmo. I think that Rock and Reigns fight might be coming to this WrestleMania and Jerry's World hyping it up. I don't know. I'm very interested to see that. The other matches, I mean, it's like Team Raw, Bianca Belair, Rhea Ripley, Liv Morgan, Carmella, and Zelina Vega versus Team SmackDown, Sasha Banks, Shotzi, Shayna Baszler, Natalya, and one woman to be determined. I mean, that match, just because I want to see Bianca Belair, Rhea Ripley, Liv Morgan, and Sasha Banks, it's interesting. But other than that, I mean, it's a little boring. Then you go to Team Raw. Seth Rollins, Finn Balor, Kevin Owens, Bobby Lashley, and I can't remember, Austin Ayers versus Team SmackDown. Drew McIntyre, King Xavier Woods, Jeff Hardy, Happy Corbin, and one guy to be named later. Doesn't excite me, but you know what match excites me? Can I tell you? There's one match that I'm wanting to watch.
Didn't you just name three matches right there?
Nah.
So you're giving us the two you hate the most and then two.
No. I like the tribal chief. Yeah, the two I like the most. Have you been hearing what's going on with Charlotte Flair and Becky Lynch?
Like, what do you mean? Like, behind the scenes?
Like, so a couple of weeks ago, they were supposed to switch championship belts because Charlotte got drafted to SmackDown and Becky got drafted to Raw.
Mm-hmm.
So Charlotte was told hand Sonya Deville the belt, and then Becky will just toss hers to you. Well, she said no, and live during the segment, she throws it on the ground, and Becky kind of looks at Sonya like, "What the hell's going on?" And so after there was beef in the backstage, like all three women got into it, they were talking a lot of crap, and it's become personal between Charlotte and Becky, like. Becky was asked by Sports Illustrated the other day if her and Charlotte have a relationship. She's like, we used to. She's like, you guys don't anymore? She's like, no, we don't have a relationship. We used to be best friends. We would travel together. We would stay in the same hotel room. We would hang out.
Do you think it's real, though? Like, you think it's part of making it real, but it's fake, actually? Like,
I'm glad you asked me.
Bex, you're going to have a new nickname. Becky? Say it with me, guys. You ready? Becky, Charlotte beat me. Charlotte's far.
That's so Charlotte was like, oh, Becky's built herself up as Becky Two Belts, the man, the this, the that. Her nickname is whack. Now, let's see what Becky had to say on Monday.
All right, this is not a real drama. This is a storyline.
No. This is real.
They're doing it on the mic.
Charlotte Flair out here acting like she don't know who the hell I am. Well, let me remind you, Charlotte. I'm the person who used to be your best friend. The person who you rode everywhere with. The person who was there so happy for you with every opportunity you got and every title that you won. But the person who was also there with a shoulder to cry on anytime things didn't go your way. But I'm also the person who realized that a friendship with Charlotte Flair comes with conditions. And those conditions are that you be the star and I be the person in the background. I'm the person that said to hell with your friendship and slapped you so hard across the face, it sent me into a different stratosphere.
That sounds about right, but I still think they're playing up a storyline.
No, it's not a So Charlotte
on the
you don't think they're gonna play it off? You have to play something like this off, but this is the reason
you're saying what happened was a legit
feud. Yeah, no, I think use it. I think they used to be friends. Once Becky started getting hot, I think Charlotte got pissed off, and now everybody's like Becky. Nobody cares about. I mean, people care about her, but then this is where it kind of took a turn for. And it's not a video. It's just
another
a quick,
one. Jesus.
No. It's not a video. But this is where things got a little weird. And I don't know what you think, but
I'm not sold yet.
So Charlotte came out and said, "If I was a man, you guys would say I have big balls, and I'm out here like making a name for myself because I win so much." So fans are complaining because Charlotte gets all the championships. She's at 12 now. She's only been in WWE for 5 years. So everybody's like, "Oh, look, you get there because of your name and this and that and that." Or she's like, "If I was a man, people would be hyping me up." And Becky's like, "No, it's not that you're a man or that you're a woman. Gender has nothing to do with this. It's because you're a piece of crap," basically is what she said. So it's been getting interesting, Gilbert. This is a match that I'm honestly excited for because of all the drama that's happening between Becky Lynch and Charlotte Flair. So, and honestly, like, if she's pissed off because of that, dude, what's your last name? Like, the last name has a lot to do with it. Like, if you're Ric Flair's daughter, you're obviously going to get ballooned up. And don't get me wrong, she's incredible. She's great talent. She's one of the best female wrestlers WWE has ever had. But at the same time, when you keep on consistently beating you keep on beating talent, it gets a little bit, it does get a little bit questionable, and fans have a right to question this stuff. So, and people love Becky because Becky was like she said, the girl in the background nobody cared about. She was just a girl that would sometimes get a match on SmackDown, sometimes she wouldn't, to being the man. And now she's one of the faces of WWE. And I mean, if that pissed off Charlotte Flair, I mean, hey, they were the four horsewomen, her, Bayley, Sasha Banks, and Becky Lynch. And all four women have grown exponentially, but the thing is, two have really ballooned up, and that's Charlotte and Becky. So I think there is a lot to it, because then reports have come out that Charlotte is difficult to deal with, and that's what's gotten all this started. That everybody, there's reports coming out that Charlotte is hard to deal with, and that Becky's the one that kind of, like, in the sense of John Cena, puts their arm around your shoulder and tells you, "Hey, you just got to do X, Y, and Z to get better. Hey, why don't you hit me with this move so that you can, so that you get a pop from the crowd?" She's one of those people, and Charlotte wants her character to look strong. So that's kind of the beef that's going on right now. And I think it is real, Gilbert. I think there is a lot of beef between these people. But you know what, Gilbert? And by the way, I have Becky Lynch winning that match, and I have Roman Reigns winning the other match. You know who there's...
Sound like a homer, Fernando. Two of your favorite wrestlers picking them.
Bro, that's your tribal chief. I just don't think that they're going to... The thing is, I don't think they're going to make Big E win because of...
I wasn't trying to keep you going, Fernando. Let me just do it for you, because I told you a time limit and you're going to go further than that, Fernando.
It's fine, though.
Speaking of real feuds, because I don't think this feud is real. The feud with Dan and Dago and I is legit. So can we go to your brother?
No, it's not. It's a friendship. I don't think I've ever said that. It's a friendship. You guys love each other. But let's kill him now. Let's get, look at your face. That's so funny. All right, now let's go to Dan and Dago and see what he has to say.
Now it's time for Una Vez, and Fernando wants to see what Humberto considers a good vacation. You know that slacker is all about taking time off. He's afraid of heights, so this should be another interesting and creative segment for Fernando. So let's get to Una Mas.
Good stuff from Dan and Dago as always, Gilbert. Gilbert, do you want? I know you just got back from a vacation and everything.
Like a month now.
Well, whatever. You just got back from a vacation. Longer, though. Do you want to take a vacation with me? I mean, I know you went with your girlfriend partner, but would you ever want to take a vacation with me?
Where are we going?
We're right now. Pack your bags. We're going on a virtual vacation. When you went to your vacation down in Puerto Vallarta, you did some fun stuff: zip lining, horseback riding. Now I want to see what some of these things. If you would do some of these things, Gilbert, you tell me if yes or no. Are you ready for this? Are you excited?
Sure. I guess.
All right. Would you do this, Gilbert?
I don't know. Where's the equipment? Are you dumping?
No, they're just sitting at the edge in Norway.
Yeah, that. I'm sorry. Wait, bro, it's a podcast. Can you bleep that out later, Fernando? Sorry.
I got you, bro.
Bro, the people not on the YouTube, there's a woman here. You're looking over a very, very high mountaintop. So, yeah, that's why I said F that.
All right. Next one. Let me delete that one. All right, Gilbert.
You know I'm afraid of heights, so that's why.
I know you are, we're going on a virtual vacation. We're going to see what you would do.
No.
All right, here goes. Here goes the next one. Would you dive into the world's deepest pool? It's in Dubai, 60 meters deep. Look at all this.
I see a lot of equipment, scuba diving, a tank. I will do that one.
Look at that.
Okay. I would be kind of terrified that my scuba. Ooh, you're playing pool. Okay.
They have libraries. Look at all that, dude. Can you imagine? This is in Dubai, by the way, like I said.
Man, they're going deep. I would do it, but I'd be a little scared to go lower and then have my. I'll be panicking that my equipment will fail me. So I can't be down there too long, but I will do it.
All right. Next. Where are we going? Ah, here we go. In Zimbabwe, Gilbert, the Victoria Falls, it's called Devil's Pool. Look at all that. Look at how she's on a waterfall. She's looking down. She's literally on the edge of it, like holding on to somebody something.
Grabbing her legs at least.
I don't know. Look at that. Look at the rainbow, Gilbert.
Nah, I could see the beautiful view from 20 feet away from that. So I am good on that one. That is too close. I am not doing that one. It's a nice view, but I am not doing that one.
Oh my God. These are amazing. And Gilbert, don't go anywhere. I still got more.
I got one out of three.
Okay. One out of three. Would you go to Peru? And look at this. Stay in waking up in a glass pod, suspended 1,200 feet in Peru. Would you do this?
No. Maybe.
Look at that. Look at her waking her up. Look at that.
If I'm there for like a good like maybe 5 minutes, I will be there to check out the view. But I am not sleeping there. I will not be able to sleep. I'll be freaking out. So no,
I wouldn't do it either. I wouldn't do it either because this would be a mean fluffy joke. And if I even rolled over, I feel like I'd be going down. So yeah, I ain't doing this one either. That was a good. Yeah, no, that one's creepy. Like you know that one's creepy. Let's go to the next
one. Out of four. I am not a.
You like swings?
Huh?
You like swings?
Yeah, another one.
Bro, I got more. Look at this.
It's not like, okay, let me see that one.
He's swinging in. This is Italy. A skyscraper swing. Look at this.
I could do that one. That's not too bad.
Look at that.
Yeah, I could do that one. You go down, you go up. You're not up the whole time. It's not too high. You got some equipment there to hold you.
2,275 meters above sea level. Imagine that. Look at this. That's crazy. Gilbert, don't go anywhere. I still got five more.
What the?
I got more, bro.
You got all two. Right. You gotta show me five more.
Because it's fun. I want to see what you would do. Look at this one. Bungee jumping. This is in Russia. This is sky. Like they're bungee jumping. They're throwing themselves off. Look at that. Oh,
no, I won't do that one. They just tossed her.
Look at that.
Painful. Yeah, I can't do that one.
Oh, you wouldn't do it?
No. So I only have two that I would do so far.
Okay, hold on. We're
this marathon of extreme adventures.
Bro. Oh, remember when we went to that's one of my funnest memories when we went to the Pirámides de Teotihuacán. Remember that?
Yep.
Okay. Would you do this on the Great Wall of China? Remember how the steps were all little? Look at this. Look at that. So this guy's on the Great Wall of China and he's going down the stairs, but he's like, he literally puts his butt on the seat and then he kind of goes down.
I gotta see the view. Like, how high are we talking here?
I don't know. But look at that. That's steep. And those, you know, those stairs are small, like the ones in Teotihuacan.
Yeah. But not to the point where you have to sit down and do it. So,
well, Eric,
I have all the information. I'm gonna pass.
You're gonna pass? All right. Three more. Ah, actually, two more.
Nice.
All right. Would you do this? Let's see. Look at this. This is in Italy also. So basically, like, they're going through this, like, what would you call it? Like a bridge, but it's, you can only take one step at a time. It's like a small thing. I'm sure they have like a lasso or whatever holding on to them, but you look at that.
Okay, I kind of did this in Puerto Vallarta. I wasn't maybe that high, but if I know there's equipment holding on and I'm holding on to something like a bridge, I don't have the information here, but I will say I will do it.
All right, there you go. So what are you at, four?
Three.
Three, okay. Last one. Oh, I hope it's a good one. Oh, yeah, it is. Speaking of swings, would you do this one? Watch this.
Yeah, I could, that's probably the one I would do the most. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
With no gear, no nothing. He's just literally on the side of the mountain.
You're not that high. You're just swinging. I guess you got to hold on. Like, as long as he doesn't push you off the seat, I guess. A little reckless, I guess, but it's not. You're not that high.
All right. So you did four out of what? How many do you think I gave you? 10?
Like 12.
Okay. Wait, they were all good stuff. So definitely, that was. Did you like that? Did you like our vacation?
It's a little long, but sure.
No, it wasn't. It was only like 5 minutes long. I'm staying in my time limit, but obviously, did you like that, Unamas?
It was cool. Yeah, you're getting creative every week, so
I'm trying to stay creative.
You put in effort, so I like that. I appreciate that. That's what I try and do
every single week.
Even though I tell you every week, let's keep the show to an hour, and then you go longer, and then you cut into Unamas time. That's my only issue.
No. We'll get better. We're still practicing.
Oh yeah, we didn't have a guest today, and you still didn't get better.
Hey, no, it's fine. Oh my God, it's not like we shot over like an hour 15.
We get it. We're gonna go longer now talking about
exactly. So there you go. So quit complaining at me. So obviously, guys, thank you guys so much for rocking with us today. Thursday, we have a very special guest jumping on with us to break down Chargers versus Steelers. Who's gonna play for the Steelers? Who knows? They have a lot of injuries. They have a lot of they have two of their best players on COVID with Minkah Fitzpatrick. Quarterback Ben Roethlisberger. We'll break it all down for you guys on Thursday. And again, after the game, I know it's going to be late, but Gilbert and I will have a post-game Compas on the Beat episode. Thank you guys again so much for rocking with us. But for the time being, you know what? Sunday Night Football, it means a long week, and a lot of eyes are going to be on us this week, Gilbert. So you know what? Sabes que vámonos.
That's right. Sunday Night Football. Pittsburgh Steelers in town. So we got a lot of things to do this week. So ya nos vamos, pues vámonos.